Jekyll? Dr. J?
My name is Mr. Hyde!
The hell happened to them? Julia Roberts carries us forward. I am your host, Patrick Skeyhill, and joining me is the bungalowed Joe Vekeman.
I like your haircut. Congratulations.
Oh, yes. Yes, thank you. And of course, on the audio boards is Lev Van Rensselaer, reminding me to remind you that you can email the cast at whathappenedtothemcast@gmail.com. And our sponsor this week is Elio's Pizza, the only pizza made from eels and not from concentrate. All right, Joe. What movie are we doing this week?
Mary Reilly. And let me quickly just segue back to the eel. Well, I want to go to the eels. You brought up eels. There's an eel, like, de-skinning right at the beginning of this movie.
I know. I imagine that's why they wanted to sponsor this episode.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Don't agree with that.
All right. Well, it's don't be mad at the sponsors. They pay our hosting fees.
I just think that they... Do you think they watched Mary Reilly? Do you think anyone else has watched Mary Reilly?
All right, go into the plot synopsis.
Okay, Mary Reilly. A housemaid falls in love with Dr. Henry Jekyll and his darkly mysterious counterpart, Mr. Edward Hyde.
If there was ever a movie I was happy I did not read the preview of watch a trailer for, it was this one. Let me tell you my experience of watching the first 10 minutes of this movie.
Please.
I go to the place where I'm going to buy the digital rental, and there's a picture of Julia Roberts in, like, sad, tired, immigrant outfit, maid outfit.
Yes.
And then I read, like, the first three words of the summary. It's like, Julia Roberts plays an Irish servant, and I go, oh, my God, I'm going to get Girl with the Pearl Earring, and the movie's 2 hours.
Oh, no.
And then it starts off with her cleaning. Then, like, this doctor comes in, John Malkovich.
Yep, John Malkovich.
She's just cleaned the floor, and he gets it dirty, and she's, like, got to clean it again, and he's being a weirdo. And then he goes into, like, his office, and it says, like, Henry Jekyll or something, and I go, wait, are we getting a secret? Dr. Jekyll movie? And then like 10 more minutes goes by and I somehow forget it because I'm just watching boring made period piece stuff.
Yeah, and then the walls come crashing.
Then he like howls like a wolf and runs outside and I go, oh shit, we are. Long before everybody, there were sexy sparkly vampires in Twilight. We got sexy, muscular Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde.
Played by John Malkovich.
John Malkovich. And I guess this movie almost got remade with Russell Crowe.
Oh.
Yeah.
We would have been so blessed. But the Dark Universe did not work out.
Yeah, thank goodness. Yeah.
Oh, you didn't want to see Tom Cruise come back as a mummy and hang out with fat Russell Crowe as Dr. Jekyll?
And like Angelina Jolie, not as Grendel's mom, but as like Bride of Frankenstein.
Oh my God, was she in it? I know Johnny Depp was the Invisible Man.
Yeah.
Ugh.
All of this is stuff I don't want. This movie. Might this be the worst directed movie we have watched so far?
Through all the filmographies?
I know, right? Like it's perhaps odd. And now let me explain this. Julia Roberts, John Malkovich, obviously good actors, but like I have no idea what either of them are doing in this movie. I have no idea what I'm supposed to feel for most of this movie. I'm very confused at what the goal is here. Are we a romance? Are we a horror? Like, and like, just like weird little, like the maid is like, oh, I saw Mr. Hyde. It's like he came out of darkness and disappeared in darkness. But the scene we see, there's not 1 ounce of darkness in it.
Yes.
And like, he's just like a little half ahead and he's like, boo. And then like, he goes, and I don't listen. Did you read the book?
No.
I read the book in like fourth grade.
You're very smart.
So I don't remember all of it, but basically I remember him jumping up and down on the little girl, or that might've been the politician. He's jumping on somebody, but also like, it's from his point of view. I don't remember if Mary Reilly was a character. She certainly wasn't important. It's like all from his point of view. And like, he isn't aware of the Hyde parts. like he's hearing them secondhand and like piecing together that he's doing it and piecing together that Hyde is like making it harder and harder for him to turn back. And like at the end of it, like he's just, he realizes it's the last time he's going to be Dr. Jekyll, and like then the book ends. And so like this was like a really weird take on like the whole it was Robert Louis Stevenson, I think. It was Robert Louis Stevenson, like he had a dream. He dreamed he was Dr. Jekyll and had that whole thing. And when he died in the book, that's when like he woke up from the dream and he just wrote it all down.
Wow. That's like,
so like, but like this weird love triangle thing is weird. Having Dr. Jekyll, like, I'm sorry, having Mr. Hyde be like a very reasonable dude was odd. Like he steps on the girl, but then like he's like, here, here's a check. I'm sorry about that. And then like he's chasing after her, but then says like, here's a key. Why don't you go? So like, is he enraged? Is he not? And also, how does nobody know it's the same person?
Yeah, they just have different hairstyles. That's how I was like able to tell them apart.
Well, like it's the same. It's clearly the same face. The mustache that he has is not enough.
Yeah.
And maybe you could be like, you could not expect that he would be two different people at the same time. So I could, but nobody's like, he looks just like the doctor. It's really weird. Are they like nobody's like that. And like not, and for a love triangle, none of that romance is here. There's like a little bit of a hint at the Electra complex that Mary Reilly's supposed to have, Julia Roberts. Mm-hmm. But like it never really mattered. I never thought she was going to, like there's a little bit at the beginning where you think she's going to fall in love with the doctor, but the doctor basically disappears afterwards. And like there's this whole backstory with her father to explain why she might be into like this type of figure, but then the father comes back and then like it didn't matter. Like she's just like, you don't have to pay for the funeral. And then she walks away.
Yeah, what did you think of when he kissed her rat scars?
And then she like likes it. Yeah. She's like into it. And then he's like, I thought we were going to do it because I could smell your genitalia moisture.
Oh,
and
God.
You're like, what the fuck is this movie?
I didn't like it. I felt uncomfortable the whole time.
Like, it's like, it is the same level of what the fuck are we doing here as Southland Tales, but none of the charm.
Like, yes.
Yeah.
Thank you. Perfectly.
Like, there's so much I'm confused why it was done, but, you know, it is what it is.
Yes. Let me tell you what else this director made.
Yeah.
You want to hear? All right.
Yeah.
High Fidelity with John Cusack.
Oh, okay. Well, that's a reasonable movie.
Philomena.
Oh, I like that movie.
Yeah. Dangerous Liaisons, which I was talking about earlier. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Florence Foster Jenkins.
I've never heard of that movie.
Oh, God. How did you missed? Where were you doing in 2016? How did you not see that fucking movie?
I don't know.
You saw everything in 2016, right?
I know. I don't know how. I don't even remember that movie.
All right. Meryl Streep, Hugh Grant, Simon Helberg. Meryl Streep is a New York heiress who dreamed
Ricky in the Flash.
Yeah. I mean, the year before she did Ricky in the Flash.
All right.
Who dreamed of becoming an opera singer despite having a terrible sing.
Oh.
So she's like self-aware that she really can't sing that well. I can't believe you did. I must be confusing that with Philomena.
Now, when you give me that synopsis, I'm remembering the trailer now.
Yeah.
I didn't see it.
That's so funny.
But I remember the trailer.
Yeah. So My Beautiful Laundrette. With Daniel Day-Lewis.
No, I don't know that one.
That's from 85. Wow, very young. The Queen, which won Helen Mirren her Oscar.
Yeah, yeah.
Ooh, Victoria and Abdul. Do you remember that trailer?
No, I don't.
Wow. Every time I was at Kendall, that trailer would play. I don't care if it was in January or December. I would see that trailer. Like, I'm talking like through the year. Just never stop playing. The Grifters with Angelica Houston. And John Cusack, Annette Bening. I've never seen that. Now we're just running into just like, what are these? Like I see Lay the Favorite, Quiz, Mrs. Henderson, Cherry, The Snapper. These are movies I've never heard of. I've at least heard of those first like five movies I told you about.
It is wild that this movie came out, seen by people, and that this director has continued to work.
Yeah, he's made 55 films.
Well, that kind of at least makes sense.
He just works.
Like, we're at the McDonald's stage of a director here. So, like, of course they're going to be like this.
I mean, this is what Tarantino talks about all the time. He's like, 10. I'm just making 10. Enjoy them.
Well, like, if you're coming out with a movie every year, unless you're a wild man like Godard, Like, they just can't be great.
Or fucking Altman. Don't you soil his name.
But Altman's got a lot of highs and lows, though.
Yeah, but I'm telling you, those first, like, 5 years in the 70s, he owned those first 5 years.
Yeah, and then, like, Antonioni has, like, world-famous films from, like, 1960 to 1968. He's got five of them in 7 years. Like, it can happen, but...
Incredible.
Mostly not. So, yeah, we've never heard of this director. Hopefully, we'll never hear from him again. Julia Roberts' accent seems to kind of come and go.
Oh, that's an IMDb fact, you know?
And like, the times that it's there, half that time, it sounds like she learned it from Dennis Hopper.
What, in Blue Velvet?
No, what was that? Early Julia Roberts movie we did with Eric Roberts?
The Blood something.
Yeah, Blood Simple, maybe.
Blood Simple's the Coen Brothers movie.
Oh, okay. Then I don't know.
Hold on. I'll pull it up. Just keep talking.
Julia Roberts' hair.
Julia Roberts' hair, long, beautiful hair, shining, gleaming, steaming, flax of acid. Give me down to there, shoulder length, longer. Here, baby, there, mama, everywhere, daddy, daddy, hair.
They do a good job of making it look frazzled, except when she is not working. And then it has to look really sexy and well-brushed and shampooed, which felt like an odd dichotomy.
Yeah.
Also interesting, her hair, like, goes down to her waist. And I have no idea how she hides it under that tiny hat. It doesn't seem possible.
Tiny hat.
She has, like, a little tiny maid's hat. And somehow, 8 feet of hair is hiding there.
Blood red.
Blood red.
How could we
forget? We were close. I don't understand why every time I see a movie that takes place in the 1800s, somebody is washing a stone floor with a rag and water. What is that doing? Well, how do you not have a broom?
I don't have the answer to that, but I will.
And people are ironing shoelaces in this movie. What is that accomplishing?
Ironing shoelaces.
Yeah.
That is the most pointless objective someone has ever been given.
Yes. It's just like, here's some busy work. There's a couple of scenes.
Hold on. Can I give you the tagline to this movie?
Yeah.
It's terrible.
Okay.
Evil is irresistible.
Oh, my goodness. I'm so happy I knew nothing about this movie.
Ugh.
The surprise on my face as I realized what we were what was going on was palpable.
Wow. Just a couple more things. The Roger Ebert review, as I really need to point this out. So he awarded this film 3 out of 4 stars, feeling the story is in some ways more faithful to the spirit of Robert Louis Stevenson's original story than any of the earlier films based on it, because it's true to the underlying horror. This film was not about makeup or special effects or Hyde turning into the Wolfman. It's about a powerless young woman who feels sympathy for one side of a man's nature and horror of the other. He really dug that movie.
Also, like, I don't think most of that is accurate. I don't think he saw the movie we saw. She's not that afraid of the other guy, because he's very seductive, apparently. And there's no horror. There is no horror in this film. Nothing horrifying. Also, perhaps we remember the climactic transformation where it's all special effects and, like, a weird baby John Malkovich is coming out.
It looks like Mr. Burns was coming out.
Yeah. You know, I love it when people see John Malkovich in a movie and they're like, John Malkovich. Like, from being John Malkovich. And I go, well, you know, there was a time before people were in John Malkovich's head where he was just a regular actor.
Wait, are people don't know that he was, like, that there's no, like, historical context for his career now because
yeah,
he's in
exactly
that
like that's what I run into. It amuses me.
That's insane. I mean, yeah. I agree. That was the first thing I saw of it.
I was hoping when you were teasing this Robert Ebert review that he was, like, gonna tear into it. Like, it's the most confusing mess of a movie I've ever seen.
He continues. So, many found fault with Roberts calling her miscast. Malkovich also received his fair share of ill mention. Here, too, Ebert disagreed, deeming the performances subtle and well-controlled, noting Malkovich in particular as quiet but simmering with anger.
There is nothing subtle about either of these performances.
Yeah, I know. This is so...
And I don't why is John Malkovich is as Mr. Hyde is, like, the most, like, nice... genuine Mr. Hyde I've ever met. He's like kind of a dick sometimes, but like that's it. What is that?
I don't know.
The whole point is that like Dr. Jekyll is like waking up from his Hyde fugue states and like hearing about all the horrible things. And I don't know why Mr. Hyde is like ripping apart like a possum in a bordello and like he jumps on a woman but then feels bad about it. I don't know why he kills that senator guy. or I guess whatever they're called in the House of Commons. Well, I don't understand any, and like he's collecting, he's bringing Julia Roberts along so they can collect organs. Why? What did it all mean? What was the point of it? And like he's like trying to make it so that Dr. Jekyll doesn't have control over him anymore. But then like he smashes Julia Roberts up against some walls, breaks some glass, and then she like doesn't love him. And he's like, well, I guess I'm going to kill both of us then. And like that's endless. Like, I don't know why anything happened in this movie. I have no idea.
I agree. Bad movie. Guess what? At least it was like 100 minutes and not anything longer.
Julia Roberts' mom is just like dies and then like shoved in a box.
Yep.
And I thought there was going to like that guy, that grave guy, and then like her father, like both of these were figures that were set up for like Mr. Hyde to like come and take revenge for her. But like that could be like how she, that didn't matter. I don't know. Like Wes Craven had a weird Phantom of the Opera movie that was kind of like this, but at least it was better at doing what it wanted to do.
What was this called?
Might have just been called Phantom of the Opera. And like the Freddy Krueger guy, I think, plays the Phantom.
Wow, really? Hold on.
Yeah, and then it turns out that the whole thing was a dream, or was it? So, particularly great. Maybe it was a Dario Argento film, actually.
Okay, well, the different people. Would it have been Body Bags?
No, but like with Freddy Krueger, the Freddy Krueger actor was in that.
Only an actor in that, sorry. Oh, I think it's The Serpent and the Rainbow. No, that's not it.
No.
I don't know. I've never heard of this.
All right, that's okay. We can look it up after. So when you saw Mr. Hyde transform back to Dr. Jekyll, was that better or worse than the PS2 Scorpion King?
You know what? I actually was like kind of impressed by 1996 graphics for that. I was like, that's not as awful. Like, because Scorpion King, that was so like, oh my God. They're a good. You know what came out in 2001, the same year as the Scorpion? No, sorry. You're talking about the Mummy Returns was in the Scorpion King.
Yeah.
So whatever. The Lord of the Rings. I know. The first Lord of the Rings came out in 2001. And yeah. That movie still looks incredible. That Scorpion King is unacceptable.
Yeah, it's odd stuff there.
Let me give you the budget for this. It was.
Yes, I was wondering that.
Budget is $47 million. Where is it?
Yeah, it's a little more than I thought you'd be in like the 30s, low 30s. 47 million. Okay. And then how much did it make? 68 million.
Tried 12.9.
Oh, thank goodness.
This was a giant bomb and everybody knew it.
Yeah, Julia Roberts having a tough time with her dramatic roles.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's interesting to know. I wonder how that will affect the role she takes afterwards. Real quick, the movie, definitely, despite being a female-centric romance movie, does not pass the Bechdel test. Surprise.
Well, because Malkovich is always like, I need the center of all attention. This is my movie, even though the movie's not titled fucking Jekyll and Hyde. It's titled Mary Reilly.
Yeah, and like, but even when she's in scenes with other women, they're talking about the man that they serve. Like, it's everybody's working for Malkovich in one way or another, so like, there's no way around it. One of the servants, played by Michael Sheen.
Yes, very young.
Good Fight alum.
Yeah.
He had a very impressive season 3 on that show. And is the guy, like, the mean boss servant guy, was he the fat dude in Dune?
Is that Michael Gambon?
I don't know any of their names. I've seen him somewhere, and I thought he was...
That's a Lynch I haven't seen still.
Yeah, good kids, okay. Don't worry about it.
Well, that's the reason why I haven't watched it. I want to keep it very peaceful in Lynch land. I like all the ones I've seen. Although, I do want to watch A Straight Story. That's supposed to be good, right?
You think so? I don't know.
You haven't seen A Straight Story?
You know what? I actually completely forgot about The Straight Story.
Wait, you've seen it though, right?
I have not seen it.
What? You know where? You know where it's on? It's streaming on Disney Plus. There's a David Lynch movie on Disney Plus.
Was that a Fox movie? Is that how they got it?
I believe so.
Okay, well, that makes sense at least. I want to talk about this, like, pathway to get to his laboratory. Mm-hmm. One of the pathways that, like, involves, like, a hanging catwalk.
Yeah.
That's, like, a T-bone, and there's, like, a door to the house. There's a door to the laboratory, and on the other side is, like, a stairwell. Mm-hmm. Here's the weird thing about that stairwell. It does not go all the way down. It only goes to the catwalk, and then there's, like, 10, 15 feet below that where the stairwell is just like, we're done. Here's my thought. Just build a hallway. I don't understand why the catwalk is the most efficient architectural solution. I also thought we might get a scene where, like, it starts to, some of the wires get cut and, like, it tilts down. Didn't get that. He just, like, somehow is hanging below it, reaches up and grabs her, and then somehow we cut to her drag. He's gotta, like, pull himself up, get over, keep her from running away. I don't even think that's no wonder they cut away. That couldn't be done.
Can we be done with this one? Let's wrap this up.
Yeah, that's not really. We're just gonna shit talk it, trash talk it for a bit.
Yeah, and I don't want to. I this movie wasn't worth shit talking about.
It's just. I don't know what. I have no idea what it's trying to do. Like, I can't. I don't even know how to talk about it. Usually we come here and it's like, I think the movie was trying to do this, and here's why it failed, and here's how you could have done it better. Yeah. I have no idea what this movie wanted to be. I cannot fathom. I have not read the book. I imagine it's like some weird Fabio covered trashy 80s romance novel, something like that. And then this leads into like Twilight and stuff. And then like you get fan fiction to be like 50 Shades of being John Malkovich, something like that.
Oh.
Yeah. That would be sexy.
Kind of.
I don't know. Like, listeners, if you are more familiar with the story than I am, having read it sometime within the last 20 years, which is nothing I cannot say, you know, let us know. Like, is Mary Reilly in this book? Is she an important character? How much of the book did they carry over? I don't know. Like, hearing that Roger Ebert review, I'm like, do I not remember that book as well as I do? But then I think, did Roger Ebert even read that book? Like, I don't know.
Did Roger Ebert even see this movie, or is his face buried in the popcorn? Like, what's going on here?
I don't know. Like, I'm usually okay with most of Roger Ebert's
Me
reviews.
Too.
This one just feels like so out of left field.
This is like his bad take about Reservoir Dogs. I can't believe
I wonder if he
I mean, that movie is like, wow. I mean, everyone talks about Reservoir Dogs. Whatever. Let's go on.
Yeah, I think, I mean, sorry for a bit of a short episode. We were also beset by technical difficulties on our side. So we had to kind of cut this one short a little bit anyway.
Yeah.
But I don't even know. I'm out of notes. I don't even know where we could go.
We're doing our last look.
We did the hair thing. We did the Bechdel. Like, there's not, we did the budget.
Yeah.
I don't know. That's it.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's just no one cared about this movie. And I just don't know why Julia was like, I read the script for this one. I think it's really good. Don't you show up day one on that set and be like, I should not be here. This is not where I want to go with my career.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, it does have like this like hint of Oscar bait around it,
I guess.
But it ended up having the same fate as Ron Howard's Moby Dick movie.
I saw that and I fell asleep to that movie.
I can see why she might have been lured to it, but this director just didn't know what he was doing. The script obviously needed a lot of work too, but there is a way. If you really want to lead into the romance, there's a way to do that. You didn't do that here. If you really want to lead into like the female horror and like this Electra complex, there's a way to do that. You didn't do that. With like minor changes to the script. I mean, obviously fundamental ones would help, but
yes,
there's something salvageable here in this trashy romance novel, and you didn't find any of it.
Yeah.
And everybody left thinking like they had done something. Like, isn't John Malkovich being like, hey, why is Mr. Hyde exactly like Dr. Jekyll? Should I do something a little different? Should I have like a voice perhaps, or like a weird pot? And he's like, nope, I love it the way you are. I want you to be polite and gentlemanly and every now and then kind of a dick.
Can I tell you something?
What?
And we get probably a lot of shit for this.
What?
But a good like modern day Jekyll and Hyde, Venom. Tom Hardy plays the shit out of that role. That movie might be trash, but he is so good at it.
All right. Well, there you go. So, yeah, watch Venom, and we'll wait for Julia Roberts to be in one of those.
I mean, that is something that totally could happen.
Could Julia Roberts play a Marvel villain someday?
Oh, my God. Let her play a villain. Oh, my God. Yes, Patrick. Thank you.
That could be fun. Are you listening, Julia Roberts agent, wherever you are?
Are you a big Tony Leung fan like I have become?
Oh, and Wong Kar-wai?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's fun.
He is the villain of the next Marvel movie coming out on September 3rd.
What is he like, in his 50s?
Yeah. And he looks
holy shit
amazing as always.
Well, I'm glad he's still relevant.
Yeah. I'm so excited. This is like, oh, Marvel. I'm like, oh, interesting. Really?
What I appreciate about going through the Wong Kar-wai collection 6 months later.
Yes.
Is, you know, I do the Letterboxd reviews.
Uh-huh.
And then like a day later, I look back and I go like, maybe I liked that movie more than I thought.
Yeah, you do.
Like, so I had the benefit of watching Days of Being Wild the second time, which certainly helped. But like, I'm looking back on Fallen Angels and I gave it 3.5 stars. But I'm looking back, and I'm like, should that be 4?
Yeah. I mean, I gave it 4, but I rate,
like, I'm looking, like, I'm like, I'm like, is that, I felt like a little less special than Chungking Express. But I look back and I go like, no, maybe I'm really into it. I don't know. I might watch it again.
You should. I really like that one. That's like the like opposite of like Chunking Express. Like you just get the other.
Yeah, that's what I said. It's the.
I felt that way too when I watched it. I was like, oh.
As I guess, you know, watching those features, one of those mini movies in Fallen Angels was supposed to be in Chunking Express.
Uh huh.
But then the movie would be too long, and they also said, well, this one happens at night, and these two happen at day. And then it was going to be like a sequel, but then it wasn't. It was only like a spiritual sequel. It takes place in the same. Like I said, in the review, it takes place in the same areas. But you would never know.
Yeah.
They look and feel completely different.
Last thing. Did you watch Happy Together yet? That was my favorite one.
No. So I've got those last three to do.
Okay.
In the Mood for Love, I've seen before, but the other two I've not.
You're in for a treat.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I will be checking those out soon. I've got to get through a few other things.
All right. So we did the last looks, right?
Yes, Joe. What are your last looks?
Julia, the hair. Don't do that ever again, please.
Well, I feel like they made...
Or the
like
eyebrows. What was the was her eyebrows?
Yeah, so they did that. They wanted to... Like, I think they had to dye them to make it match the red hair.
Yeah.
So, like, this is interesting, right? So she couldn't obviously be a Southern person in this movie. But they said, well, we need a redheaded actress.
I wish she was Southern. Bring that Georgia accent back.
They said, we got an Irish character, so we need a redheaded actress.
No.
And so, like, they had to dye those eyebrows. But they also kind of made it look, like, old, right? Like,
yeah.
The oldest she's ever looked was in... And I know she's the oldest she's ever been, but, like, she's, like, she looks like she's, like, in her mid-30s.
Yeah.
So, like, I think they wanted to frump her up. And, like, that works sometimes if a woman wants to win an Oscar. Look at Monster. So, like, I don't know. Like, it's part of this Oscar chase. So my last look is something like, I don't know. Clearly, I think she really was going back for these Oscar noms. But, like, your last few films have tried to do this, Julia, and it never seems to be working.
Uh-huh.
It might be time to try something a little different. Now, again, we've got like 2 years to see if that change is going to happen because she's doing all these movies simultaneously. But, you know, I imagine the romantic comedies are going to start coming back because they pay better and do more successful. And that's nothing to do with Julia Roberts' acting ability.
No,
it's
no.
Just she's picked like really bad scripts to do.
It's absolutely the material. She's just finding the wrong material.
Yeah.
And it's just not right. And it sucks. And it's just like, get back on that horse. Find the horse.
Yeah. You know, looking back to that Dennis Quaid movie, remember when Dennis Quaid played like a George Bush type president in a romantic comedy?
When? What?
It was just like I don't know, 2003 maybe, 2004. I don't think George Bush was involved in the romance of the romantic comedy,
yeah.
But like Dennis Quaid, George Bush was like in a lot of the trailers making a lot of the jokes, and the Dick Cheney person was like trying to explain the conflict in the Middle East to him.
What
and then like he's making bad jokes about it, and then in the meantime there's like two people falling in love. Go look that up after we wrap up. But that came to mind after we had done that movie last week. Okay. Well, that's got to do it for us. I would like to thank Lev Van Rensselaer for mining those audio boards, keeping us sound so slippery smooth. I'd like to thank my co-host, Joe Vekeman, for sticking through all these technical difficulties today. And, of course, I am your host, Patrick Skeyhill. You can find my features, documentaries, short films, video essays, animations, behind-the-scenes footage, and so much more at QuixoticUnited.com. And now, all of our audio-related material on our sister station, Quixotic Harmonics, including this and other podcasts. Thank you all for listening. Joe, say goodnight.
Good night.
Kaboom, doom is nervous large. You could tell by his blooming room service charge. Dark and tall to boot. The only thing was wrong is he was bald as a coot. Used to ran a van from Peter Pan to Red and Tan. And keep the human foot for his dead man's hand. This is when the mask was brand spanking new. Before it got rusted from drinking all the brew.
All right.
Okay.
I think we might have something here. So you had sent that David Lynch thing, the Instagram one.
Yeah, you're talking Ben Affleck.
So no, Zack Snyder.
Oh, okay. Oh yeah, I've seen that one. Yeah, it's funny.
And he says, "Hello, friend. This is Zack Snyder, who made Man of Steel. I lost my credit card, and I need money to finish making Justice League 2. Can you send me $1,500 in Amazon gift cards? I have Ben Affleck here with me as well." And then it says, "Hello, this is Ben Affleck."
Yeah.
So he said, oh no, people are catching on to my David Lynch ploy. Let me use the exact same wording and substitute in two other celebrities. I like that he thinks that movies need to be made with Amazon gift cards.
I mean, I think he's just trying to get Amazon gift cards.
Yeah, but he's not. Why does he want Amazon gift cards? Cash is just better.
I mean, yeah, but you can send someone like a code for an Amazon gift card. You can't really say cash.
You can send someone a code for cash. It's called PayPal, baby.
Very true. How could I forget? Also Venmo.
So what, Brian De Palma, I should check out Phantom of the Paradise?
Absolutely.
Okay. Well, then I'll do that.
Let me give you three. I'll give you three.
Okay, three.
Body Double, Phantom of the Paradise, Hi Mom. Watch them in any order you want.
Okay.
Just know that Hi Mom and Phantom of the Paradise are 4 years apart. Same filmmaker.
Good Night Mommy. Gotcha. I can do that.
Also, Hi Mom is like 80 minutes, Phantom of the Paradise is 90 minutes, and Body Double is the longest at an hour 50.
All right, those are all fixable.
Yeah.